Near the end of his earthly life, Jesus traveled to Jerusalem with his disciples. Each day, he taught in the temple. It was just before the celebration of the Passover, and although many people loved Jesus and his teachings, the religious leaders had conspired to stop Jesus altogether by killing him. Jesus knew that his time left on earth was nearing an end, so he gathered his disciples, whom he greatly loved, together for a meal. In the middle of the meal, Jesus stood up from the table, took off his outer clothing, and tied a towel around his waist. Then he poured some water into a bowl. He went to each of his disciples and washed their feet with the water in the bowl, wiping them dry with the towel around his waist. When Jesus came up to him, his disciple Peter said, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" Jesus replied, "You do not realize now what I am doing, but later you will understand." "No," Peter said, "you shall never wash my feet." At the time, washing someone's feet was a task that was given only to hired servants. But Jesus replied, "Unless I wash you, you have no part with me." So Peter said, "Then, Lord, not just my feet, but my hands and head as well." When Jesus finished washing his disciples' feet, he put his outer clothing back on, returned to the table, and asked his disciples, "Do you understand what I have done for you? You call me teacher and Lord, and rightly so, for that is what I am. Now that I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also should wash one another's feet. I have set you an example that you should do as I have done for you." Later in the meal, Jesus reflected again on what he was trying to teach them. "A new command I give you," Jesus said. "Love one another. As I have loved you, so you must love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you love one another."
Hey, Tim Kepler is heading for Japan at 5 a.m. in the morning, all right? So you be praying for him as he departs from here, gets home, gets packed, is at the airport bright and early. He'll be engaged in ministry for a couple of weeks in Japan. And that's always a very exciting time for him and them. Most of you have heard the story, but he got connected with a Japanese evangelist several years ago over there. And the reason is, after Whoopi Goldberg's movie came out, Sister Act, the Japanese love black gospel soul music. All right, they love it. All right, and so he told me, that's why I got this from him. And he said, so this evangelist brings Tim over, all right, and that brings the crowd out, and they get a chance to share Jesus both in music and message. And so be praying for them as they travel. Welcome to New Hope Church today on Palm Sunday 2015. It is great to have you here. It's also the last Sunday of our Believe series. We've been engaged for over 30 weeks, all right, looking at 10 key truths, 10 key practices, and 10 key virtues. Think, what do you believe? Put what you believe in practice. Act. And then, once you think and act, God will produce in you His character, and we will be who God intended us to become. And we wrap that up today. And so, thanks for being here for our final Sunday in the Believe series. It's great to have you here. If you're visiting with us today, there are visitor cards in the pew in front of you. I would love for you to take a card out. If you're a guest, fill it out. Drop it in the offering bag. We're not going to hassle you or bother you on the phone or at your doorstep, but through the mail, we'll send you information that answers a lot of what goes on around New Hope. Plus today, and you'll hear more about this in a minute, when you walk out of either door today, don't miss the ministry fair going on under the pavilion. It'll tell you lots about the church you won't find out anywhere else. And you'll hear more about that in just a minute. But we want you to take advantage of that. But thanks for being here. Got a clipboard coming around. There's two things. They pertain to the same event. And that is our egg-citing Easter egg hunt. That's going to be this coming Wednesday evening. This is for all elementary age kids, children, all right, and down, sixth grade down. and it's going to be from 5 to 6:30, so it's early. There are no other Wednesday night activities going on around the church this week, so it's only going to be the kids' outreach on Wednesday from 5 to 6:30. They're going to hide Easter eggs. They're going to have pizza. They're going to play games and have fun together for about an hour and a half. It's on Wednesday, which is April the 1st. I made a suggestion to our children's group leaders, and none of them have liked it. I think they ought to have an Easter egg hunt and don't hide any eggs. And yeah, and then when they can't find any, say, April fools, wouldn't that be so cool? I just think that would be awesome, all right? But they're not going for it, so there really will be eggs for your kids and your grandkids to find. If your kids or grandkids are going to be coming, there is a place on each clipboard towards the back for you to sign your kids up so we know somewhere back here, really there is, okay, they're supposed to be. Right there, okay. So sign up so they make sure they have enough Easter eggs and stuff. And then on the top sheets, if you would be willing to help with some donations for that event, things like veggies and juice. We try to be healthy around here, so veggies. And those will probably all get thrown away. And then chocolate and non-chocolate candies, okay, which are on there, for which we'll probably run out of. And then the plastic eggs in which they're going to hide stuff in, okay? So if you can help out with any of those, please sign up, and that will be of great, great help, all right? So two things on the same board pertaining to the same event, all right? Read your bulletin. Doesn't it look really cool inside, huh? Did you all notice? Looks a little different, huh? Looks really nice, all right? So read it. That way I don't have to spend a whole lot of time covering it. You're going to hear about a few things during our offertory today. But let me... remind you, you can start filling out the plugged in, all right? It's an insert to be our last Sunday for you to get these filled out. You can start filling them out right now so you can put it in the offering when it comes by. If you've been here a long time, please still fill one out. We're going to update all of our computer information so we're accurate. If you get this in today, after the third service, all right, all these will be put into a big barrel, and we have an opportunity drawing. We'll be giving away three things. Peggy will tell you about that in a little while, but please fill those out, get them put in. Last night was a special night for one of our small groups, because one of our small groups had two families who now have new members of their family. One family has a new daughter-in-law, and the other family has a new son-in-law. And the Butterfields, it happens to be my small group, all right, that I'm sort of been kicked out for a few months right now. But anyway, but they're still my small group. But the Butterfields now have a new son-in-law. Their daughter got married, and I now have a new daughter-in-law. My son got married last night, and so, yeah, it was pretty cool. It's also the reason I'm wearing these jeans, because this was the uniform for the wedding last night. And, yeah, I got to tell you, I like this uniform for weddings, all right? This was really good. This was better than a suit any day. Also, my last chance to wear, you know, our Believe shirts, and there's some others around who've got their Believe shirts on. So, anyway, special night last night. Hey. This is the kickoff of the greatest week in the history of the world. This is the greatest week in history of all times. It is this week which gives us Christmas. I hope you understand that. It is this week that gives us Christmas. If this week had not happened, we would never have heard of Christmas, ever. Because it took this week to validate the birth that took place in Bethlehem. It took the resurrection to validate that. And so this is an incredibly good week. So I hope in all of your adventures, kids being out of school, trips you've got planned, stuff that you're going to do, I hope at the heart of all of that you take time to recognize the value. And recognizing the value means we'll be engaged in worship and communion and conversation with God, with a heart that overflows with all that He has done for us. So thanks for being here as we kick off this week. We have about 45 people in San Diego right now. They're worshiping in a church just before they cross the border in a couple of hours. They've got about 5 more hours of drive time. They left here yesterday at about 8 a.m. and got to San Diego in a very timely manner and got to be able to go down to the beach for, I think, a couple of hours before they got to the church. They spent the night there and got up this morning having breakfast and worship, and then they will head on in. So be praying for our 45 folks, both junior high, high school, and adults that will be engaged in ministry in San Quintin, Mexico. So exciting opportunities for them. I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward and wait on us this morning as we have our morning tithes and offering. And today you're going to have a little bit different style of offertory. In fact, I'm going to ask Nick and Peggy to take the stage, if you would. These are our two newest staff members here at New Hope. You've heard about them. Many of you have met them, but you haven't always seen them. So let me do a quick introduction. And once we pray, they're going to be the offertory today. They're going to share some things about what each of them do. This is Nick, and that's Peggy. All right, let me just clarify that quickly. But Nick is the newest member of our pastoral staff, and he is engaged with young adults and families, all right, young married couples, families, and engaged in ministry with them. And then standing next to him is Peggy, and she was just hired as our director of ministries. Peggy comes alongside every ministry we have in the church for the purpose of encouragement, for doing research to help them, to do evaluation, to take each ministry so that we're doing better now than we did yesterday, and we can do better tomorrow than we're doing today. And she has just been wonderful, coming alongside every one of our ministries and getting acquainted. So you're going to hear more from them in just a moment. But let's pray, and then we'll have our morning tithes and offerings. Father, thank you for the beauty of this day. Thank you for the satisfaction of being able to wake up this morning and literally say, this is the day that my Lord has made, and I'm going to be glad and rejoice in it. We can rejoice over the past blessings. We can rejoice with today's mercies, and we can rejoice with tomorrow's promises. So we say thank you today. Father, you know the condition of each one of us as we walk through these doors today. Those conditions may range anywhere from joy-filled to discouragement. Can range from troubled hearts to triumphant lives. No matter where we are on that pendulum of emotions and thought and circumstance, we all can come with a surrendered heart to you today, and we can discover what you have in store for us. And so I hope we will be mindful to those sitting around us, but most of all, I hope we'll be mindful of the voice who speaks within us, your voice. Thank you, Father, for the privilege of giving and sharing today. We commit all this to you in the awesome name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. There was a children's Sunday school teacher who normally had straight hair, but one week she went and got it permed, and it was really curly. That next Sunday morning, she noticed that four-year-old Jack, one of her students, who was normally cheerful and bubbly, looked really sad and bewildered. And she said to him, is something wrong, Jack? And he mumbled, your hair. And Jenny said, oh, you noticed. I just had it permed and I love it. And he said, really? Have you seen it? I'm not sure that is an illustration of humbly, but it is an illustration of humiliation, all right, which are not necessarily one and the same. As we have been engaged in this last 10-week segment of the Believe series, Think, Act, and Be, 10 key truths, 10 key practices, 10 key virtues. Those 10 key virtues are the fruit of the Spirit plus two. Do you remember what the two additions are? Hope, okay, and humility, all right? If you haven't had a chance, this will be one of your last chances to go out and sign the walls of truth. There are three different walls out there in the pavilion. What do you believe? What do you do? Who are you? All right? The 10 key truths, 10 key practices, 10 key virtues. Go out and sign them if you believe them. As we come to the conclusion of these 10 virtues in our life, I don't know if I've made this comparison for you. You've probably picked it up on your own already. But these 10 virtues kind of divide nicely into 5 and 5. The first 5 virtues, love. This is the love of God in us. Joy. It's not happiness. This is joy. Joy that comes from Jesus' presence in us. Peace that passes human understanding. A life that is under control, and hope. All 5 of those are significantly engaged in our vertical relationship with God. When we have Him in us and we are believing the truth and practicing the truth, this relationship that goes vertically is very, very healthy, and that healthy vertical relationship will express itself in the fruits called love, joy, peace, control, and hope. The last five virtues, patience. Do we need much patience with God? No. He needs a lot of patience with us. Okay? Where patience is exhibited in our life is not us in this vertical relationship, it is with each other in our horizontal relationships. You need patience with me when it gets to be time for me to end, and I don't. I need patience with you when you're looking at your clock, tapping on it when I haven't finished yet. We need patience with each other. The next, kindness and goodness. Okay? This is about how we treat one another. Faithfulness. Yes, there is this characteristic of faithfulness between us and God, but this specific term really has to do with our faithfulness to each other as we love our neighbor and love ourselves, as we love our enemies too and being faithful to them. This is about gentleness and how we respond and treat others. And then today is kind of the summary, and it's humility. And these have to do a lot more with our horizontal relationships and the influence that we have in our horizontal world. As you heard me say in the opening, just as Easter validates Christmas, I believe it is this last fruit that we look at today, humility, that ensures that the rest of the other fruit in our lives is genuine and not artificial. I think humility is that one characteristic that validates all the others. For it is by humility that patience is genuine. It is by humility that our kindness and goodness will be real. It is on the basis of a humble heart that faithfulness and gentleness will be expressed in our lives. So the subject of humility is so very, very important. Paul W. Powell once observed, "Pride is so subtle that if we aren't careful, we will become proud of our humility." It's a challenge to us. When this happens, our goodness becomes badness, and our virtues become vices. We can easily become like that Sunday school teacher who, having told the story of the Pharisee and the publican, you guys remember that story? All right? The Pharisee wanted to be moved to the front of the table, all right? And he ignored, and he was rude to the publican, and Jesus told this story, all right? And the Sunday school teacher at the end of her class, after telling that story, said, "Children, let's bow our heads and let's thank God that we are not like the Pharisee." I think there's a little bit of pride in that prayer. You see, Proverbs 16:18 is very correct. It is pride and a haughty spirit that goes before a fall. In a certain pond, there were two ducks and a frog. And they were neighbors in that pond, and they were the best of friends. They played together all day long during the summertime. As the cold drew near and the water dried up, the ducks realized they would have to move. And this was going to be easy for them. They could fly, but this was going to be really hard on their friend, the frog. And so finally it was decided that they would take a stick, and they would put it in the bill of each of the ducks, and then the frog would hang on to the stick with his mouth, and they would fly off to another pond, and the frog could go with the ducks. And so they did. As they had been flying for a little while, they flew over a farmer, and he looked up, and he said to his wife, "What a great idea! I wonder who thought of that?" Proudly, the frog said, "I did." Thus illustrating, pride goes before a fall. All right. You guys are really sharp today, all right? I wondered about that one. Philippians 2, it's the key verse in the last chapter of your Believe Bible. By the way, hardbacks, I believe, will be here by next week and will be available in the pavilion. We've had the paperbacks during our engagement with Believe as a beta church and trying to help them, but now the real one is out. It's in hardback, and it does have the scripture references on each page, all right? A request that you made, and they made that change. And so these will be available, but the key verse for today is found in Philippians chapter 2, verses 3 and 4, and it says this: "Do nothing do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others more than you value yourself. Not looking to your own interests first, but each of you to the interests of others. The year was 1884. King Humbert of Italy was awakened at midnight by a messenger informing him that an epidemic of cholera had broken out in Naples. Though the king was scheduled to be in Monza the next day for this magnificent reception in his honor, he telegraphed his hosts, "Banquet at Monza, cholera at Naples. I'm going to Naples. If you don't see me again, goodbye." John Stoddard, historian, tells what happened after that. He writes, "On reaching Naples, King Humbert found only the common people at the stations in the city to receive him. The rich, the aristocracy, and almost all of the officials of that community had fled town. The king, however, did not care for that. It was the people that he had come to save. For weeks, he worked incessantly to check the plague and to relieve the sufferers. He entered the hospitals. He took the hands of the sick and the dying in his own hands. And by his example, he shamed the other officials into duty. After a week, one of his ministers said to him, 'Your Majesty, there were 3,400 more cases yesterday. This is getting alarming. Ought you not to return to Rome?' 'You may go if you like,' replied the king. 'I shall remain in Naples till it's free from cholera.' And he kept his word. He stayed until the city was well." You see, when a king descends his throne to serve those that he rules, and he risks his life, that may be the grandest picture of the meaning of humility that we can find anywhere. And isn't that exactly what Jesus Christ did? Jesus stepped off of his throne and he humbled himself and he became a man born in a city of Bethlehem as a baby. God as a baby? God going through a birth canal? God with a diaper? He humbled himself to become a man. In most kingdoms, people offer their lives to save the king. But in God's kingdom, King Jesus offered his life to save the people. Humility has nothing to do with humiliation. It's not about maintaining a low self-esteem. It's not about having a lack of confidence. Jesus certainly did not suffer from a low self-esteem, and yet he lived his life completely in humility. Many have come to view a humble Christian as a doormat for others. In reality, a believer in Christ has a strong sense of their value to God and a secure position of identity as one who no longer feels the need to elevate themselves or pump up personal pride. King Humbert was still the king, whether he was sitting on the throne in Rome or whether he was serving on his knees in a cholera-infested city of Naples. You see, the state of his heart is what determined his true position and place. Often with respect to our own physical appearances, the word modesty connotes that we're not flaunting our features. That's why these Levi's aren't too tight. We want to avoid revealing ourselves in such a way that makes others uncomfortable and invites wrong attention. Think of humility as the modesty of the heart. We work to not flaunt who we are or to be revealing of ourselves in a way that makes others uncomfortable or to invite the wrong attention to who we are. You see, for the Christian, humility means life is not all about me, but rather, it's all about God and others. In the book of Proverbs, the wisest man who ever lived sums up in chapter 15, verse 33, with these words. He says, wisdom's instruction is to fear the Lord, and humility comes before honor. You are going to see in several verses how wisdom and humility seem to be twin fruits on the same branch. Here's the key question for us today. What does it mean to value others before ourselves? Humility is the opposite of arrogance. An arrogant person wants their presence to dominate a room, while a humble person desires to make their contribution to the room about those who are in it. They want it to be inclusive. Practicing humility is not about blending into the wall and not being noticed. It's about being open and unassuming to bring out the best in those who are around us. Arrogance often makes assumptions as to what others might be thinking or feeling, while humility will make no such assumptions. A humble person desires to be warm and welcoming to any with whom they come into contact. When Jesus attended a dinner where people were jockeying for the best seats, he told a story about seeking the lowest place and then being invited to relocate to a better place. Jesus said, you know, there are some people who come in and they want to go right to the head table. And he said, it's kind of sad when you go right to the head table and somebody escorts you away. Much better if you just take a seat in the back and wait for somebody to ask you to please come to the head table. He said it's much, much better. He said, for all of those who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted. Luke chapter 14. You see, in the view of Jesus, those who desire self-exaltation are at the opposite extreme of those who are his followers. In the end, his kingdom will be revealed as contrary to the way things normally function in this world. All those who have lived to be exalted will instead be humbled, while those who have served both him and the neighbor will be rewarded. Jesus modeled this in his own life. The one who in the Old Testament is described as the Lion of Judah. He's the King. Bless you. I wish I could sneeze that sweetly. That is so nice. Mine sounds so ugly. But this Lion of Judah, the King of Beasts, when he's first noticed publicly in this world, how was he described? As the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. The Lion comes as a lamb, humbly. Just waking a few folks up. We're good. Key idea. I'm going to say it twice, then I'm going to say it a third time and point to you, and I want you to say it back to me. All right? Key idea. I choose to esteem others above myself. I choose to esteem others above myself. Y'all don't follow directions very good, do you? I'm going to say it three times. I'm going to point to you. You're going to say it back. Okay? Now, I've said it twice, so I'm going to say it a third time, then I'm going to point to you, all right? I choose to esteem. Patience, yes. Amen. I am going to say it the third time. I will point to you. You will then all say it back, okay? Do you have this much problem with Bullard, Tim? I choose to esteem others above myself. Good, you are. You've got the hang of it. Give yourself an applause, all right? You got it. You did good. You see, Scripture consistently connects these two words of humility and wisdom. Consider this insight from Solomon in Proverbs chapter 11, verse 2, when he said, when pride comes, then comes disgrace. But with humility comes wisdom. How about this one from the half-brother of Jesus? In the book of James, chapter 3, verse 13, it says, who is wise and understanding among you? Let them show it by their good life, by deeds that are done in humility that comes from wisdom. In a masterful way, wisdom brings together knowledge, life experience, and a personal skill set that allow a person to live their life successfully. And that is true for every single one of us, regardless of our personalities and abilities. It is wisdom that brings together knowledge, life experience, and our own personal skill set and allows us to live a life in God's economy that is successful. The wise person has a broad vision to be able to see their place and is not threatened by anyone else's position, for they are secure in the place that God has them. Thus, the wise person is free to be humble. We would be hard-pressed in all the scriptures to find anybody more eligible for God's Hall of Fame of Faith than Moses. But listen to what Numbers chapter 12, verse 3 says as a description of Moses, this pillar of the Old Testament. It says, Moses was a very humble man. Very. Not just a very humble man. Listen to this now. That's not enough. He's more humble than anyone else on the face of the earth. Wow. This is a strong indicator of the fact that God chose him. And he blessed his life. The man in Scripture who may have been the most humbled by God also ended up becoming one of the most effective men in the history of God's kingdom. When we are first introduced to a character by the name of Saul in Acts chapter 7, this guy is overseeing the execution of one of Jerusalem's deacons, disciples. His name is Stephen, and he's being executed. And this well-educated leader of the political world had taken on a mission to single-handedly wipe out Christ's followers. In Acts chapter 8, verse 3, the scripture says, Saul began to destroy the church. He went from house to house. He dragged off both men and women, and he put them in prison. But one chapter later, in Acts chapter 9, everything changes. Humility came when Saul was confronted by Jesus. In Acts chapter 9, verses 5 through 9, we have a brief part of the story. Here's how the scripture reads. Saul had been struck down by a bright light on the street, on the road to Damascus. And here's where the conversation comes in. Saul asked, "Who are you, Lord?" I've always found that one of the most funny questions of all the scripture. It's like me walking up and saying, "Who are you, Joe Avila?" How much sense does that make? So here is Saul saying, "Who are you, Lord?" And I love Jesus here, all right? I love Jesus everywhere, but I love the way Jesus handles this. Jesus says, "I am Jesus." You've already called me Lord, all right? So he says, I am Jesus who you are persecuting. You obviously know me. Now, since you've called me Lord, I've added that. It's not actually in the verse, but I'm adding that. Now that you've called me Lord, get up and go into the city. And when you get there, do what you're told. If you're going to call me Lord, then shouldn't you do what you're told? So he sent him to town. He said, when you get there, do what you're told. The men traveling with Saul stood there speechless. They heard the sound but did not see anyone. Saul got up from the ground. When he opened his eyes, he could see nothing. So they led him by hand into Damascus. And for 3 days, he was blind and he did not eat or drink anything. And you can go read the rest of the chapter and you'll find about his miraculous recovery of his sight as his heart opened up to the presence of Christ in him. And he was no longer one who persecuted the church. He was now part of the church that was being persecuted. Paul's teachable spirit brought him to the place to later write in the book of Romans, chapter 12, verse 3, these words, "By the grace given me, I, Paul, formerly Saul, tell every one of you, do not think of yourself more highly than you ought, but rather think of yourself with sober judgment in accordance with the faith that God has distributed to you." What an amazing contrast. Which one again proves the fruit that Christ can bring to a surrender and submitted life? Humility. Here's the key application. What difference does this make in the way in which I live? It's going to be five observations that we're going to make right here. What difference does this make in the way in which I live? Number one, humility brings a secure knowledge of our identity in Christ. Christ offers to all of us who have this new life in us, He creates a new identity for us. His death and his resurrection provide security both now as well as in eternity. Our newfound knowledge of what he has done for us produces a grateful heart and a humble state of the heart as we continually find our life and our breath in him. As Dr. Luke writes in the book of Acts, chapter 17, verse 28, Luke says, "In him, Christ, we live. In him, we move. In him, we have our being." I was probably 15 years old before I knew that was a verse out of the Bible and not a prayer my dad prayed. Because growing up as a kid in church, Dad often said in his prayers publicly, he would say, "Father, we are grateful for you, the one in whom we live, move, and have our being." I thought my dad had written that. Because I'd heard it all the time. And then I found it in the Bible and I said, "Guy, Dad stole it." But he was praying biblically right. I think, not to draw attention and stay humble, but I think of Peggy at a career that she had been on. But she came to a place in her life where she discovered it is in Christ that she lives. And it's in the influence of Christ's circles that she wants to move, and it's found in where he wants her rather than maybe where she wanted herself, that she finds her being and she transitioned away from one very successful area to another area that makes a difference for eternal perspectives. Humility, number two, brings the freedom to elevate and to esteem others. When we're secure in our position, we then can easily lift others up. We have the resources we need to live out the greatest commandments, love God and love our neighbors. This continual growth of humility allows us to feel no threat or no insecurity in placing God's will and others' needs ahead of our own. We are set free in our soul to serve. Humility redirects all of our relationships to be about the well-being of others and not ourselves. Once we learn to consistently esteem others above ourselves, the next step is to care for people in the way that Jesus would have us care. We seek to serve all of those with whom we are in relationship with. We no longer use others as a means to our own end, but we make it a practice to ask, how can we be a part of God's plan for people? We seek to follow Paul's advice. No one should seek their own good, but we should be interested in seeking the good of others. 1 Corinthians 10:24. When this becomes a reality in our lives, we will begin to see needs that we have never noticed before. We will begin to hear the hurts of others that we never listened for before. We will begin to speak life into others that we have never spoken to before. We will touch hearts in ways that we have never touched before. This is simply modeling the life of Christ that he led on earth. Number four, humility brings a deep sense of caring for the people in our circles of influence. Humility brings a deep sense of caring for those who come within the circle of our influence. As Jesus moved throughout the crowds, he had this amazing ability to find or be found by those who had the greatest needs. From the woman who touched the hem of his garment, from Zacchaeus who had climbed a tree, to Nicodemus who sought him out late at night, to the woman who was caught living in adultery. No one was exempt from the attention of Jesus and his care. Income, education, gender, cultural status had no bearing on his willingness to minister to people. Everywhere he went, he looked out in compassion to those who needed him. This too was our job description. Driven from a humble heart to serve as Christ served, from the convenience store clerk to the doctor, from the homeless man and woman to the politician, we treat everyone the same. And number five, humility brings a desire to reflect Christ in all things. The ultimate humility is found when we place our heart in the constant position of putting God's glory first and seeking his kingdom and his righteousness, as Jesus said in Matthew 6:33. The more that we immerse ourselves in the ministry of Christ to others, the more we experience the abundant life that he offers. Seeing him change lives through our obedience is humility at its finest hour. For growing Christians, a strong sense of self-worth flows from understanding how much we are worth to God. This frees us to focus on improving the esteem that others have of themselves. When they enter any conversation with a neighbor, the prayer is, "Dear God, help me place this person above myself and enable me to draw them to you." As the world becomes increasingly self-absorbed, humility will not only be one of the most attractive and refreshing fruit of God's spirits to a searching and hurting world, but also a great blessing to our own lives in offering our hearts daily to the Lord as we exalt Him and Him alone. Listen to these verses of Scripture as they point us to this great blessing. Proverbs 22:4, humility is the reverence of the Lord. Its wages are riches and honor and life. 1 Peter 5:5, all of you. Who's that mean? Yeah, that means you. Clothe yourself with humility towards one another, because God opposes the proud, but He shows favor to the humble. You want God's favor? Humility. Jesus humbled Himself, and in due time, God the Father exalted Him to the highest place and gave Him the name that is above every name. He promises to do the same for us. James 4:10 says, "Humble yourselves before the Lord, and He, God, will lift you up." As I prepared for today, starting a couple of weeks ago, realizing humility would fall on Palm Sunday, my mind began to run. And I thought, wow, I don't know if Randy Fazy and his team, who kind of laid out this calendar, were really that smart. And they realized that humility was the absolute greatest subject to begin Palm Sunday with. Or if it just was the way the calendar fell. But God did it well. God did it well. Consider this week. It started with Jesus riding into the city of Jerusalem on the back of a donkey. It continued with a small group gathering of 13 people to observe Passover and to ignite the Lord's Supper. During those festivities that night, Jesus did the unthinkable. He took a pitcher and a towel and a basin, and He poured water in it. And He did this after supper. Washing feet was a practice you did when you first entered the door. But all the disciples at that moment were jockeying for positions of influence in the discipleship of Christ. So nobody washed anybody's feet. And Jesus noticed. And when supper was over, after those disciples had had to endure each other's dirty feet, Jesus, with towel, pitcher, and basin, got on His knees and He washed every one of them. Later that night, Jesus ended up alone in a garden to pray. After being alone in a garden praying, He then was betrayed and arrested and beaten and spit upon and humiliated. And yet the Scripture says, He humbly opened not His mouth. The one who could have called 10,000 angels. He was prepared to die alone for you and me. He ended the week crucified on a cross. Not for the things that He had done in this life, but for the things that we deserved. He took my place. In these events, notice the humility of Christ. First, He was submissive to the people of Jerusalem. He rode in on a donkey, not a stallion. Notice how submissive He was to His disciples. He washed their feet. Though He was their Lord, He served them. On another occasion, Jesus said, "Though keen I am, I did not come as a king. Though your Lord and Master, I didn't come to lord it over you. I have come to serve you." Notice in this last week, this Palm Sunday week, notice that He was submissive to His Heavenly Father, for as He prayed alone in the garden, Jesus, the man, said, "Father, I don't like what looms ahead of me. Could you change it? However, I don't want my will, I want yours to be done. Submission to his Father. Notice next, he was submissive to his enemies. He accepted betrayal. He accepted arrest. He accepted accusations. He accepted beatings. And he opened not his mouth. And most of all, notice in the adventure of this last week, Jesus was submissive to the needs of the world. He died a death he did not deserve so that you and I could live a life we could never earn. John 3:16 became true, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. And the only begotten Son was okay with the plan, and he gave his life. Why? So that you and I might not perish, but we could have everlasting life. Philippians 2, beginning at verse 5, describes it this way. Paul says, in your relationship with others, so you and me relating to each other, have this same mindset as Jesus, who being in the very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used for an advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking on the nature of a servant, being made in the image of human likeness, being found in appearance as a man. He humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God has exalted him to the highest place, given him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee will bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Here's the picture, folks. Everybody who betrayed him in life, everybody who denied him in life, everybody who was part of his persecution and rejection in life, there will be a day in their future, whether living or already dead, there will be a coming day when every knee will bow towards Jesus and say, you are who you said you are. I got to tell you, folks, I want to be part of that crowd who's already acknowledged that truth here. Because heaven will be my eternal reward. If I have not done that here, I will be on my knees in hell acknowledging Jesus for who he is. And I don't like that opportunity. Let me wrap this up. I grew up in a church culture that every year at this time, we had a special service. It would usually be either on a Sunday night or on a Thursday night of the week. It was a feet washing service. It comes out of John chapter 13. See, everybody kind of likes the idea of communion. And so they like to practice it a lot. You need to understand, the same night that communion was established, feet washing was introduced. The scripture says Jesus took a pitcher and a basin and he poured water in it and he washed the disciples' feet. Culture that I grew up in, we would hear a sermon and we would sing some songs. My dad would send the women to one area, to another building, and the men to another area. They would line up chairs either right across from each other, two rows of chairs facing each other, or they would make a big circle. And you would either wash the feet of the person right in front of you, or you would wash the feet of the person right next to you. There would be a basin and a pitcher that was there, and you would have a towel, a long towel that you could tie around your waist and throw over your shoulder, and we would get on a bended knee in front of the person next to us, and we would ask this question: do you consider me worthy to wash your feet? Am I worthy to be your servant? And they would say yes, and we would wash their feet. And we would take the towel off our shoulder and we would dry their feet. And we would gently put them back in place. There is nothing more humbling in life I've ever done in my life than wash feet. Side note, from a very early age of observing those services and participating in them, I was glad that I was a boy. Because I just had ankle socks. I didn't have to take pantyhose off. I was quite blessed with that, all right? I never witnessed one. I just kind of, you know, it was a picture. But it was a very humbling experience. That is what Jesus did that night in the upper room. Jesus washed the feet of his disciples. It was a selfless offering of love and acceptance to others. In reading the scriptures, I also found in Matthew chapter 27, after Pilate, who Jesus had been given to execute, and Pilate had interviewed Jesus, and Pilate said, I find nothing wrong with this man. And they said, crucify him anyway, or we're going to kick you out of office. And Pilate found an obscure law that said, hey, you know, I can give a choice to the people of who to set free. He picked the worst guy in prison, Barabbas. And he said, you want me to set free a murderer? Or you want me to set free Jesus, who I find nothing wrong with? And they screamed for Barabbas. And Pilate, being the politician that he was, the scripture says, he poured water. Doesn't use the word basin, but he had to pour it in something, so I'm assuming it was a basin. And the scripture says that Pilate washed his hands of Jesus. What happens to him is not my fault anymore. I have nothing to do with this. You see, one basin symbolized by a selfless act of humility to and compassion for the needs of others. That was Jesus before the disciples. The other basin, Pilate, before the multitudes, symbolized by selfish attempt to free oneself of guilt, condemnation, and responsibility. One basin, an act of selfless love. The other basin, an act of self-righteous manipulation. Here's the question I have for you today. Which basin have you been washing in? Which basin are you more familiar with? Which basin represents your life and your love for God and for others? You see, you get to choose. You get to choose to be selfless or selfish. You get to choose to reflect Christ, or you get to choose to wash your hands of Him. The choice is yours. Which basin are you most familiar with? Let's pray. Our Father, this is a week to learn lessons of humility. These two basins have been on my mind for days and days. Father, I hope there comes a moment for all of us that we literally destroy the second basin, and it no longer is even feasible for us to access it, because we have become so consumed with your life in us that humility is a natural fruit of our life. But Father, there may still be looming in our world Pilate's basin. We cannot free ourselves of the consequences of rejecting you. We cannot free ourselves of the consequences of apathy, which is Pilate. I don't think you've done anything wrong, but I'm not going to stick my neck out for you, Jesus. I think you're a good man, but I'm not ready to embrace you as my Savior, so I'll just wash my hands. So, Father, if there's that man or woman who's sitting here today and they discover at this moment that they've been washing at Pilate's basin, they've been dipping from Pilate's pitcher, then, Father, I know you're prepared to hear their confession, to destroy that pitcher and basin and offer to them a new way of life in you. Thank you, Father, for the difference you'll make in us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Have a great day. Hey, ministry fair, right out in the pavilion. Take a walk through the new Jam Center, all right? Thanks for being there. Think about the basins.